I see you got a boat, Mark said. Does it run? We were standing behind the house looking toward the barn. The boat was about halfway into the barn, but it was such a tight fit, I would never again try to park it there. Yes, we took it out on the lake. I finally have the title. Long story. Do you have time to help me put it in the water? Sure. Needs a little work, though, he said, stating the obvious. The boat was at least 30 years old and had not been mothballed in a garage. Pick out some vinyl fabric and I'll reupholster those cushions. I'll fix up the steering wheel and make us an awning. You can do upholstery? I asked. I shouldn't have been surprised. I had found over the years that there was very little he couldn't do. He was a master carpenter, an electrician, a plumber, a mechanic, and an all-around handy guy. Without him, I would have sold the place long ago. Used to have an upholstery business. Well, okay, tell you what, you help me fix up this boat, keep it running, and we can share it. You can take it out anytime. All right, my son loves to water ski. We drove the boat down to Cove Lake for its maiden voyage. I managed to back it down the ramp, and Mark detached it from the trailer. We were ready to go. The engine started with a nice vroom, and we set off across the lake. It was great. The wind was in my hair. The water surged around. I had a feeling of freedom and power. As soon as I rigged up a yoke, I'd be water skiing, or at least my grandchildren would. Halfway across the lake, the engine started to sputter. Uh-oh. We turned to go back, but it died completely within seconds. We were stranded in the middle of the lake. Luckily, there was an oar, so we paddled to shore. Mark examined the engine. There's oil leaking into the gasoline. That's not good. Can you fix it? I don't know that much about boat engines. Better take it to a marina. The nearest marina was in Russellville, more than an hour away. They agreed to look at it and get back to me. A week later, they gave me the verdict. The engine was shot. It would have to be rebuilt or replaced. I looked at that sad old boat and just couldn't see putting any more money into it. The marina people wouldn't accept it as a gift. So I paid them for their time, hitched up, and headed back toward the mountain. Just as I was entering Subiaco, I felt an ominous wobble. I pulled over to the side of the road and examined my car and the trailer. One of the trailer tires was flat. With a great deal of difficulty, I unhitched the trailer, leaving the boat by the side of the road. I was tempted just to abandon it, but the license would lead straight back to me. A garage in Subiaco sent a boy back with me to the boat. We hitched it up and drove on the flat tire very slowly on the verge of the road until we reached the garage. What kind of tire do you want? They asked. You'll need two. The other one's just about shot. Just give me one good enough to get me back up to Mount Magazine. Then I'll decide what to do. They installed an old tire, warned me it wouldn't go 100 miles, and refused any payment. I tipped the boy who had helped me. I made it back to Mount Magazine and backed the boat in behind the cold house. Then I could not get the trailer off the hitch. I tried and tried. My car seemed to be welded to the trailer. This was bad, very bad. If I needed to go to the store, I'd have to haul the boat with me. When I drove back to Little Rock, I'd have to find a parking space long enough for both the car and trailer. Wherever I went from then on, probably for the rest of my life, I'd have a broken down old boat I'd paid way too much for, wagging behind on trailer tires that were only good for a few more miles. I was about to cry when a neighbor drove past. I waved and he stopped. With his superior masculine strength and know-how, he was able to unhitch the trailer. Although I was grateful, this was just one more humiliation. Mark came by to hear the verdict. I was afraid of that, he said. These old boats, a lot of times the engine goes out. I didn't like having an inoperable boat parked behind my cold house. It was a reminder of my foolishness in buying it. I called several marinas and salvage yards, but no one would take it. It would stay there, probably forever, rotting away, keeping company with the carcass of the old Dodge sedan someone had abandoned 50 years ago in the woods just past my property line. Several years passed. The boat was still behind the cold house, still reminding me that my judgment, especially when impelled by desire and imagination, was far from infallible. Maybe this was a good lesson in humility, but does anyone actually like such lessons? I certainly don't. I figured I'd have to sell the house to get rid of it. One of the conditions of sale would be that the boat went with the house. Then Mark approached me with a proposition. His son had been studying engines and had become a pretty good mechanic. Mark thought he and Matthew would be able to rebuild the engine and get the boat running again. Then he could reupholster the cushions, fix it up generally, and have a pretty good boat. That's a good idea, I said. I'm inclined to say yes, but I have one condition. Yes, what is it? You can take that boat away, but whatever you do to it, however you fix it up, I never want to see it again.